Well, ladies and gentlemen, it looks like we may have a new crazy apologist on the block. I present to you Bible Thumping Wingnut.
Bible Thumping Wingnut. I'm like, where do I know that name? You're that guy who said that atheists don't exist.
Bible Thumping Wingnut is manipulative, dishonest, ineffective, and completely incapable of seeing women as equal human beings.
Hey, Bible Thumping Wingnut, stay in your man cave and keep studying the book written in the Bronze Age.
Well, 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 what have we got here? What do we have here? Bible Thumping Wingnut.
Thank you for joining us, ladies and gentlemen. This is the Bible Thumping Wingnut podcast, episode number 22.
22?
Thank you.
Already?
22 already. Seems like we just did 21 a couple days ago.
I know, right? That's weird.
That's weird. That's because we did, folks. Right now, it's Thursday evening. We're live on Mixler because of my wonderful schedule this weekend. I'm going to be spending the entire weekend with family, the way it should be, away from Bible Thumping Wingnut. Len Pettis is with us.
Here I am.
From Wisconsin, and Colin Pearson from L.A. Are you doing well today, Colin?
Yeah, I'm good. What's going on?
Did you have a good day, Colin?
Yep.
Are you embarrassed by your new hairdo, Colin?
Yep.
Actually, Colin's not here with us today. He couldn't make it for the recording. What's he doing, like worship practice or something like that?
If I had to guess, he is sleeping or drinking beer.
Yeah.
He probably drank a beer and now he's sleeping.
Well, so. No. That's where were you not going to go because it was like too much?
My bad.
So we've got this new iTunes account. I think pretty sure we made it up to number 3 on the new noteworthy on the Christianity. We want to make it to number 1 and get past Reformed and Reloaded, which we haven't done yet.
Mm-hmm. Those guys are they're on their toes. They're on their game, but we wanna beat them because we love
them. We wanna beat them because we love them. Yeah, okay.
Right.
So the way that we can advance through that so that more people will hear about us is if you give us feedback and rate us and review us on iTunes. So if you do that, we would be happy to read your reviews right here on the podcast. As a matter of fact, Len, we've got, what, 3 for this week?
Got some new reviews. Now, this is just a reminder to our friends listening on Blog Talk Radio. That's going away very soon, so you need to go to the new iTunes feed that has our logo on it. If you're listening to the one with the black and white BTWN, that feed is going to stop being updated shortly, and you'll want to come over to this one. If you left feedback on our old one, please come and leave feedback on our new one. We had, 20 reviews over there, and we'd really appreciate those. And if you could come and bring them back to this new feed, that would be great. Now, we have a comment from Neil C74. He gave us 5 stars and says, podcast with promise. Even though they're only on their 20th episode, they've already been a blessing to me. I look forward to what lies ahead. The only change I would make is to Len's voice.
No, he didn't say that.
He totally did, bro.
You changed the words. I'm reading it right now. It says Colin, not Len.
No, that's us. We would want to change Colin's voice. But no, that just warms my little evangelical heart. But he goes on to say, Len sounds exactly like a coworker who tends to get on my last nerve. A good voice modulator should do. Try choosing a cartoon character on the settings and tell everyone he's your talking animal sidekick. It works great for Disney. Well, thank you, Neil C. Glad I could annoy you.
Hey, as long as they give 5 stars, right?
That's right. That's right. And we appreciate the feedback. Our next review comes from Cheeseburgers Are Delicious, who gave us 5 stars. Yes, that is a real username. He says, I love listening to this podcast. I recommend it. Short, sweet, to the point. Thank you, Cheeseburgers Are Delicious. And our next review comes from Dad versus Nature. Great podcast, bro. 5 stars. If you enjoy theology talk and 3 guys that say bro a lot, then this podcast is for you, bro. Bro, that's encouraging.
Yeah, bro.
That's encouraging, bro, to have have 3 5-star reviews, bro.
Yeah, bro.
That's encouraging.
You know what also is great is we put our podcast on YouTube as well, and we're starting to get feedback on YouTube from it, bro.
Mm.
So I got a couple reviews from YouTube. This is from Truth Speller. I'm not a rap person. When I was a kid, I liked it a little bit. That rap you guys put up, however, was amazing poetry that really spoke to me. I don't have a mental illness, but I know those that do. I do struggle, though, with many feelings that were expressed so well in that rap. It was an awesome message, so well done and powerfully spoken. Would you guys mind giving me the link? I would appreciate it. Thanks for sharing your views. God bless. And that's a reference to last week's episode where we played Flames War of the Minds. That's from a 2005 album. And Len, that really fit in perfect last week.
What that song taught me is that I need to prepare better for the podcast because I didn't listen to it before you played it live, and it was very emotional. It spoke to me much in the same way, and that was a heavy topic, talking about suicide and our response as Christians, and that song did fit in so well. Well written, well performed. I mean, you could really hear the heart and the pain and the struggle come through it. So I'm starting to really fall in love with a lot of these rappers that are out there because they're giving us so much more theology than what you hear on your FM feel good, safe for the whole family station.
We encourage everybody to go back and listen to that episode if you didn't. That's episode 21 about suicide, depression, mental illness. We talked about the passing of Robin Williams, and there's a great song in there by Flame called War of the Minds. Another feedback from YouTube is from Jeremy Bennett. Jeremy says, I love your show, and I love the doctrines of grace, too. So it's nice to hear others openly talk about those things. But why do you guys gotta knock the fundamental brethren?
Yeah, we you know, we're kind of equal opportunity offenders here. So, you know, if you listened last week, you heard us picking on theonomists a little bit. So, yeah, there's no one that's outside of the reach of a low blow on this podcast. So no offense. We're just having fun. We absolutely love our fundamental brethren.
Amen. YouTube, if you have a YouTube account, please go and subscribe to our YouTube account, Bible Thumping Wingnut. Just search Bible Thumping Wingnut. You will find it. We do all kinds of ministry there. We do Google Hangouts. We do some podcast update videos, and we've got a behind-the-scenes video as well. One of the main things that people come to our YouTube channel for is to watch Cy Ten Bruggenkate videos. Cy was in a couple Google Hangouts well over a year ago now, and still we get about 85 views a week. People watching for over 30 minutes at a time.
Mm-hmm. You know, and if it wasn't for you, nobody would know who Cy Ten Bruggenkate is.
Well,
so.
That's the thing. Well, if it wasn't for Cy Ten Bruggenkate, our YouTube channel wouldn't have 12,000 views per month. So
that's for sure.
Yeah. So subscribe to us. Listen. You can listen to the podcast there. Also, if you'd like to get involved in the ministry, open your own YouTube channel. Start making videos, preaching the gospel, and you'll have an audience very, very quickly.
That's right. That's right. It doesn't take long. YouTube is an atheist stronghold. Mm-hmm. And if you want, here's the deal. YouTube is like the Areopagus. What Mars Hill was to Paul, that's what YouTube is to Christianity today. So if you want people to preach the gospel to, you can go and be a webcam warrior preaching the gospel, and you will get views.
Len, on YouTube, you got some feedback, some personal feedback this week.
I did.
Mr. Lynn Pettis, are you perfect now, Lynn? You need
fired
to shut
up there, Len.
What are you doing? Stop it. Just stop.
Yeah, he was a little he was a little apoplectic there, wasn't he?
You got people fired up on YouTube.
If you do ministry, if you are a Christian on YouTube and you do ministry, you can pick who you want to do ministry to. Do you want to do ministry to atheists? They're over there. You can talk to them. If you want to talk to the cults, if you want to talk to Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, they're over there also. Mm-hmm. If you want to talk to, if you want to do discipleship and find people who are new to the faith, you can find them over there. And then there are those who like, a drama magnet. Sometimes you can get sucked into that. That's what's happened to me this week, and that was the fruit of that. So, enough said.
We have some guests this week, but before we introduce our guests, let's go to our friends at Wrath and Grace Clothing. Are you wearing Wrath and Grace Clothing, Len?
The question, a better question is, am I not wearing Wrath and Grace? Our mission here to spread the gospel with our clothing and way of life.
What's the gospel?
Jesus Christ is God in the flesh.
Who came to save sinners?
Died on a cross, nailed my sin thereto, was placed in the grave.
3 days later, he defeats sin and death.
And that man, that God, that man, Christ Jesus, rose again from the dead.
Somebody. Our desire, God will use wrath and grace as a tool to save the lost. Our hope, bring glory to God, man. All praise to Him.
Unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
And what better way than to use our clothing as the way to witness? Now you can preach the gospel and wear it too.
It's all wrath and grace. This we know as Christians, and this business is consistent with the Holy Scripture.
Stop by wrathandgrace.com and join the movement. Wrathandgrace.com.
Do you think I should ever let them forget that I helped produce that?
No, never. Never.
I haven't mentioned that since the first day we played it. I take credit for the whole thing, Frankie. For the whole thing, Jay. All of it. Can you make a commercial for us, please? This week is a special week. It's been a while since we had a guest on, Len.
It has. I'm excited today.
And we've got two guests, both of them from Jeremiah Cry Ministries. We have the founder, Jeff Rose, as well as Dave Griffin. How are you guys doing this evening?
Excellent. Excellent. Thanks for having us, Tim and Len.
Jeff and David, welcome. We're really excited to have you on. You guys are so close to my heart because I'm an open air preacher. I do street evangelism, and I'll tell you, it's people like you guys and like Tony Miano who I learned a lot from watching videos on YouTube and everything. Can you guys just take a minute, tell us a little bit about yourself? Tell us a little bit about how you came together and how you started Jeremiah Cry Ministries.
Jeremiah Cry Ministries was, the inception was in 2006. So we've been going for almost a decade. So there's been a lot of changes, a lot of different directions as far as theology, orthodoxy, orthopraxy. So, I mean, there's been so many changes from the beginning until now. It's just been an amazing journey to see what the Lord is doing within this ministry and how he's using it for His own glory. And we're in awe that we are able to go out and do what we do and get to carry this great message to the world through God's ordained means by which he has commanded us to go forth. So I met Dave, I think it's been, 2 years now, Dave, since we kind of connected? Or maybe you could tell him a little bit about that.
Yeah, it's been about 2 years now. I met Jeff through Chris Sipley and Mike Stockwell and Sidon Bergenkate. And we went to a conference in New Jersey, and from there we were preaching on the boardwalk. And I met Chris Sipley, and Chris said, well, you know, listen, you got Jeff Rose that lives 20 minutes from your house. Why don't you get linked up with him? And so I contacted Jeff, and that's how I met Jeff and got involved with Jeremiah Cry Ministries.
I'm looking at your website, Len. These guys have a really good website. We need a
they
website.
They do. We do need a website, don't we?
That would be nice to have a website. But their website, jeremiahcry.com. Looking at your staff, at your kind of like your bios, your about, I see there are 7 men with Jeremiah Cry Ministries. And I read through all of the about us. All of you have a blurb. Some of them are longer than the others. But something was missing in yours, Jeff, that was very clear in all the other bios. All the other bios included a conversion story. So I'm wondering, are you hiding something?
Yeah. Well, you know, I guess, you know, I was converted at the age of 28. I'm 43 now. People have all different kinds of stories when it comes to the date and when they were born again. I just know that someone had shared the gospel with me. It didn't really sink in until 6 years later. And I really was living a life, you know, thinking I was a Christian, but there just seemed to be a lot of hypocrisy. I didn't seem to be a genuine new birth, you know, until 2005. I was struck down by the Lord himself, I believe, and was truly converted. My eyes were opened. I was undone. It was an Isaiah 6 moment for me. And from that moment on, the direction of my life changed greatly, and it began to move towards what we see today in Jeremiah Cry. So, you know, that's probably why, because it's a long testimony, and it's like I just, you know, all I can say is that in 2005, I was truly converted. I know God is God in his, you know, eternity past. Dealing with me in the way that he has. I know that there was some light there, but I know that something drastically changed and happened in 2005. The whole direction of my family and everything changed. So
I have a similar conversion story as that, but I appreciate you sharing that. For those people who have no idea what Jeremiah Cry Ministries is all about, I mean, Len and I do, because we, you know, we have a lot of street preacher friends and acquaintances. But for those who have never heard of it, or maybe they have, but they're like, always like, what exactly is Jeremiah Cry Ministries?
The definition of Jeremiah Cry Ministries is a ministry, first and foremost, that God, its name, Jeremiah, is his name actually means that God will exalt, God will raise up. And that's where the name was. We felt that this ministry is a ministry to the church and to the world. And if you study the life of Jeremiah, you'll see very clearly that ministry was operating in his life. And we feel as well that this ministry is a ministry, obviously, to the world, but it comes through the channel of the local church. And it's also a message back to God's people as well. And the word cry obviously means to cry, means to herald. We believe that's the message, the pure gospel of Jesus Christ. So we believe that, you know, God has raised us up to proclaim the true biblical gospel in an age of compromise, great compromise. And here we are.
Jeff, at the outset, you had said that there's been a great deal of growth in Jeremiah Cry, in doctrine and things like that. And I'm looking at the About page. What it says is, we seek to restore the biblical view of Christ-centered evangelism through reformational preaching, making a stark contrast with the man-centered pragmatism of our day seen in unbiblical gimmicks and the dualistic mindset of weekend outreaches. Tell us a little bit about that growth, because it seems to me as if that's something that really weighs on you. As I've watched your preaching and listened to some of your open air, and I read this on your website, what is it that drives, and how? Where did you come from? Did you have a little bit of that pragmatism in yourself that you recognized and God rooted out of you?
Yeah. I mean, at the very beginning of the ministry, in 2006, I was birthed into this whole idea of open air preaching through the Way of the Master. Very involved in open-air preaching in Dallas, Texas. I was a local leader. I was also leading a church ministry as well. I had a very large team, you know, functioning out in Dallas, Texas. I really wasn't sure where I stood theologically as far as Arminianism or Calvinism or and all these different, you know, areas of theology. I just went out and I preached, but I was brought into the whole movement through a lot of the different things that I was watching other people do. And a lot of it was, you know, the gimmick-driven, the pragmatism, the money, trying to appeal to the sensual and selfish nature of man to try to somehow trigger an emotion, to appeal to him so that I could draw him close enough to give him the gospel. But a few years later, I had moved to Scotland and lived in Scotland for 2 years. And the assignment that was given to me was to go into the city of Glasgow and open air preach and publicly proclaim the gospel in the open air and to teach others to do it. And during the time that I was in Scotland, a majority of the books that I was reading come from an old bookstore just outside of Glasgow. And pretty much we know, if you study the historical background of Scotland, you'll find that the Presbyterianism that ran through that nation was strong. Now it's a fallen nation. Less than 1% are born again Christians. The nation's now been renamed Gangland. It's the knife crime capital of Europe. So it's a fallen nation. But a lot of the books that I was reading were these strong reform books that centered on God opposed to centering on man. And my theological position had changed. And I remember one day as I was walking out to the street, it just dawned on me that a lot of what I was doing was man-centered. And I looked over to one of the leaders of our church and I said, you know what, I just can't do this anymore. I am going to put God first and start proclaiming him as the Bible says. And I remember going out to the street, highly influenced by the books that I was reading, A.W. Pink, The Sovereignty of God. I read Martin Luther's Bondage of the Will. And I remember through an all-night prayer meeting, I remember opening up my Bible. Genesis just leaped out of the pages. It said, in the beginning, God. And I remember that having such a powerful impact on me. It was like someone just hauled up and just punched me right between the eyes. And I was just awakened in the sobriety and the reality that God first. I mean, we're always talking about put God first in our finances, put God first in our families. Right. What about our evangelism?
Right.
How come he hasn't taken the primary position and leadership in our evangelistic endeavors to the world? It just dawned on me that I was doing everything backwards. Mm. And I'm like, listen, if I can't trust God to put God first in my evangelism, then I might as well go find something else to do, because I'm not going to go out anymore as a car salesman and going out there and pulling rabbits out of my hat and everything else. And I said, you know, I'm done with all the gimmicks. I'm done with all the shenanigans. I'm putting the stilts up, taking the clown nose off, and I'm just going to, you know, proclaim the gospel, proclaim the law of God, the character of God, the holiness of God. I'm going to exalt God and let God do what he wants to do. And I remember going out that day, stood up there, began to proclaim the righteousness of God and just trusted in him. And that moment, God had brought the largest crowd. And I know we don't use the consensus to determine whether or not our preaching's biblical. And I'm not saying that. But I had the sense that God was pleased with the decision to put him first. in the public proclamation of his word and preaching opposed to just trying to sell somebody Jesus, trying to make Jesus more attractive to the population. I was trying to appeal to God as a form of worship, proclaiming his son as a form of being moved as a form of worship to God, proclaiming his son to him. And letting God move upon the hearts of men and not trying to just try to appeal to men, but appeal to God in truth. And God blessed it. And with such a large crowd that I remember one young man came up to me and he says, man, you've got all of Glasgow here. Wow. And I remember it dawned on me and I said, you know what? I said, God's in control. God is sovereign. This is pleasing to God. The Bible tells us that it pleased God by the proclamation of his word to save those who believe. I think in the original Greek, it says that this message is well-pleasing to God. Mm. And I thought, well, listen, if it's well-pleasing to God, then I'm going to stop trying to please man and just focus all of our efforts on pleasing God. And it took a turn in our whole ministry and thought, you know what? This is the direction that we're going.
I wanted to just share with Jeff and Dave that, you know, I had a very similar experience in terms of the transformation in my preaching. And what I have found is that when you preach the apostles' doctrine, you know, Acts 2:42, you know, when you preach the apostolic doctrine, the apostolic gospel, people are responsive. You get that Mars Hill response. You know, people mock, people will hear you further, and people will get saved. What I found is with the modern message, the pragmatic approach that you're talking about, that I think everyone in at some stage in their, unless they're exposed to people like you right away, but people who get into this in the early stages, they get into that, and it seems like the world is completely inoculated to it. I remember going on college campuses, and nobody would stop and listen. But when I started to preach Reformed doctrine, not in the sense like, hey, I'm preaching Calvinism, and you have to be a Calvinist, but preaching repentance and faith, you know, and not just standing up there bellowing, you know, John 3:16 all the time, because I don't know if God loves you. You know, the way to prove that is that you repent and turn to him in faith. It seems like that message is so much more impactful. And to me, that's the evidence that the Holy Spirit is behind it.
Amen.
You do more than street evangelism. You run conferences as well. The one conference that I'm familiar with is the Herald Society. I was at it last year. But I was wondering, maybe, Dave, you could chime in here. Tell us about the conferences and what they're about.
Sure. When I came aboard Jeremiah Cry Ministries, I know Jeff had already had that on his heart, something that he had been wanting to do for a while. Basically, what the Herald Society is it's more than just a conference. It's more of a training, teaching men biblical doctrine, and also a practical side as well, how to go out and preach. You know, the word says that Jesus is the truth, and therefore we can't go out to the world and proclaim a message that is false. The message that we proclaim is essential, and so we have to understand biblical doctrine. We have to be well-grounded. We have to be prepared to go out and preach, and so that's the concept behind the Herald Society anyway, is training men up, not just how to preach, but what to preach as well.
So why the Herald Society? There are a lot of conferences, and from a lot of good organizations, but if I have one conference to go to, why the Herald Society? And could you talk a little bit about what the theme is of the Herald Society this year?
The theme this year is a great cloud of witnesses, reformers and their doctrine. And basically what we want to do is take a look back at the Reformation and just men of the past in general that God raised up and used in a mighty way. So we want to look at some of the things that was central to the Reformation, the doctrines that they preached and died for. So, I'm sorry, what was the first question you asked?
Well, if I got to choose one conference this year, why the Herald Society?
Yeah, I mean, if you have to choose one conference this year, I would say the reason why you should choose the Herald Society is because this isn't just another conference. You know, it's one thing to go and to be fed and get fattened on doctrine. It's another thing to actually apply that. You know, sadly enough, biblical evangelism has been lost. You know, you can look at just about any bookstore, even solid Reformed bookstores, and you won't find a single book on open-air preaching. You won't find a single course on open-air preaching in any seminary, at least that I know of anyway. So you're not going to hear these types of messages anywhere else. So we're trying to bring this back to the forefront again.
Looking at your speakers here, of course, Jeff Rhodes is going to be speaking there. We got Cy Ten Brugenkate, Tony Miano, Jeff Durbin, Jeffrey Kirkland, Chris Sipley, Robert Gray, Mark Spence, and Kevin St. John. That's a pretty loaded stable of speakers that you got there.
I'm looking at the poster. For those of you who don't know, it's October 23, 24, and 25. It's in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania at Crossroads Community Church. And looking at the poster, I noticed that Jeff Durbin of Jeff Durbin Radio got the top billing in the list of speakers. How did that happen? Is that kind of like a demand that he put on it in order to come?
No, that was just my artwork there. There wasn't any particular order to it.
These guys don't know what to think of us.
No, they don't at all. It's like, yeah. Now they know which podcast to stay away from, right? No, we have some fun with Jeff Durbin over at Apologia, so we know he'll hear that. So now, Tim, you were going to ask a question. So,
what if you're not a street preacher? Should I not come, or is there something for just the regular guy who's not necessarily feeling a call to be a street preacher?
Here, this is such a great question, and this embodies everything that we stand for, and that we're striving for, and that is to break free from the whole sacred and secular mindset and worldview of evangelism. Let's just, you know, I remember one time I bought like 10,000 books from a guy that was a good friend of mine, John Speed, and I was selling books to bring income into my home. All these books were Christian books. And I remember digging through them all and sorting them all, and there was literally every kind of evangelism book you could possibly imagine. There was like door to door, five ways to do this, four ways to do this, backflips for Jesus. I mean, there was every single thing you could possibly think of when it come to evangelism. But it all was almost as if it was compartmentalized. It was like a fragmented, it was outside of the church. It was all these different, you know, almost these invented ways to go out and share your faith. What we have seen is that biblical evangelism and missions flows out of the local church. There are men who are specifically called to go and evangelize, specifically called to go into the world or to another country or whatever to do biblical missions. And what we find today, especially in the evangelicalism in America, is this desire to change the names and change words, like missional. You know, let's just go be missional. Everybody's a missionary. I mean, there's all sorts of different things that have been used in place of biblical evangelism. And the whole idea of why should other people come to this event? Because the whole stigma of open-air preaching, the minute you say open-air preaching or street preacher, what's the first thing that you know pops into someone's head?
Crazy. Well,
they're thinking of the Pelagian with the sandwich boards hopping up and down, being abusive, or they're thinking, you know, they're thinking all these kind of things. They got these preconceived ideas of what that means. And then we want to bring our street preaching ministry to the local church where it originally belongs, but they're looking at it like not a chance. Are we going to allow one of those kind of ministries to come into the local church? So the whole idea of the vision of Jeremiah Cry is to expose the local church to true biblical public proclamation as it's seen in the scriptures and down through church history. So when they come into an event like this, they see the difference between what they think it is and what it really is. So they come in there and they're introduced and exposed to what the Bible clearly defines as public proclamation. You see, the church has thrown out evangelism. They've thrown out the baby with the bathwater because they really don't understand biblically what the true gospel looks like when it's preached in the open air from the way it's seen and defined in the scriptures. So you got the whole family of God coming and they're going, wow, I didn't know that this is what biblical preaching looked like outdoors. I never knew that this is what evangelism looked like outdoors. So they come in, they're introduced to this and they're exposed to this and they let down their guard because they realized, hey, you know what? These men are called. Look at these guys are also family men. Look, they see the gospel as powering everything in their lives. They see the gospel as an all of life message. So you know what? It's not this dualistic, pragmatic, separated type of fragmented thing that we have. It's an all of life message in the sense that a wife can come in and she can sit and say, wow, you know what? Now I understand what my husband's doing and I can get behind that. I can support that. And they start to see, the children start to see that this is much greater than they ever thought. This isn't just dad going out and blowing off steam on the weekend from 7 to 10 on Saturday night, trying to just go out and do some sort of penance or try to just do something that's some spiritual hierarchy. But this is something that just flows out of the local church that everybody can celebrate and everybody can come into the right theological understanding of what it truly means, what it truly looks like. Then you got the open air preachers looking back at other people and saying, you know what? I can celebrate what God is doing in their life. You know, they're not condemning, you know, Aunt Marge because she isn't on the box Saturday night. People can have the freedom to be who God has called them to be. And it changes the whole worldview and how they see the public proclamation of the gospel. And people can rest in that and they can see it for what it truly is. And they can get behind it and they can support it. We've had so many pastors that have come to us and saying, wow. Even last year, we had pastors who come and came up to us and said, I never really understood, but I do now. We were just in Canada, in Calgary, and we had the pastors go out with us. They heard the vision, and one guy goes, this is the first time that Isaiah has ever made sense to me when it says how beautiful are the feet of those that come to proclaiming the gospel. It really is our whole vision is to expose the church to what true biblical public proclamation really is.
Amen. Philadelphia, October 23rd, 24th, and 25th. Registration, you can get early registration for $50 until September 15th. A great cloud of witnesses, reformers and their doctrine, the Herald Society in Philadelphia, October 23rd to the 25th. We've got Jeff Rose, Cy Tem Brugenkate, Tony Miano, Jeff Durbin, Jeffrey Kirkland, Chris Sipley, Robert Gray, Mark Spence, and Kevin St. John. Listen, I think everyone can hear the passion that you have to not just go out and be a herald and to be a preacher, but to expose the church at large to the importance and the urgency of having good open-air preaching as part of regular church ministry. This is an event we recommend everybody goes and registers for. You can go to jeremiahcry.com. Find it there. You can register online at jeremiahcry.com. You can find these guys on Facebook, I assume, right, gentlemen?
Yeah, we have a specific Facebook page that actually Dave runs.
Excellent, excellent.
There's another reason we want folks to go to the Herald Society this year, Len.
Oh, yeah.
Bible Thumping Wingnut podcast will be broadcasting live from the Herald Society in Philadelphia.
It started up the Twitter. I said that this is it. I've had enough.
What do you think, Len? Should we do some good tweet, bad tweet?
Good tweet, bad tweet. The topic this week, hashtag evangelism.
Yes. Who better? Who better to go through good tweet, bad tweet than guys from the Jeremiah Cry, guys who are out there street witnessing, involved in evangelism all the time. So this is the way we're going to do it. I just did a search for evangelism. And this is what I wrote down. Now, it was very encouraging to see that one of the people who showed up in probably three tweets within the first 10 was Tony Miano. But I'm not going to be sharing any of his tweets. They were links to articles, and he was, so they weren't really statements concerning evangelism. So I'm going to read the tweet, and then
Tony is prolific.
He is.
Tony is prolific. He's on the streets. He's on Blog Talk Radio. He's on YouTube. He's on Twitter. You can't get away from Tony Miano. We love him, though. We don't want to get away from him.
Beautiful. Okay. First tweet. Evangelism without prayer is like a soldier without a weapon. Good tweet or bad tweet?
That's a good tweet.
Yeah, absolutely.
Good. Obviously, you're not going to go out there prayerless and, you know, expect to move in power, especially in preaching his word. It's laziness, and I don't think a man should be out there even evangelizing without prayer. It's obnoxious.
All right. That tweet was from Gospel Applied. Good tweet. Next tweet is... Here's a crazy idea about evangelism. What if we start with God's love? Good tweet or bad tweet?
Definitely a bad tweet.
Oh, bad tweet. Yeah, definitely bad.
Doesn't God love everybody? Isn't that, I mean, doesn't everybody know that God loves everybody? Shouldn't we start there?
I think for one, I mean, it's lacking in understanding really of who God is, and lacking in understanding of a distinction between the law and the gospel. And, you know, man needs to understand that they're radically depraved. You know, not until man is humbled before a holy God can he see his need for redemption and grace of God in Christ. And so the law needs to be proclaimed first. The holiness of God needs to be proclaimed first. You know, man needs to be crushed under the weight of God's law before he can ever come to Christ.
Amen. Good answer. That tweet from Micah J. Murray. Next tweet. Evangelism isn't a one-time event. It's a lifestyle. It's a process. It's a way of living.
Oh, that's a good tweet.
Yeah, definitely a good tweet.
I thought so. It is by... Len, you can chime in. It's okay.
Oh, you're not disqualifying me? Because I kind of checked out there for a few minutes.
I heard you snoring. No, I heard you crying over there in the corner.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That tweet from 1 Minute Apologist. Next one. Evangelism becomes a lot easier when you realize that the God you are trying to introduce people to isn't a total psychopath.
What?
You heard it.
I'll concede my time to the guests.
Evangelism becomes a lot easier when you realize the God you're trying to introduce people to isn't a total psychopath.
I say bad tweet.
Bad.
Yeah.
See, there's a couple of problems with that tweet. Yeah. One, it fails to recognize the fact that everybody knows that God exists.
Exactly.
Okay, so you don't have to introduce people to God any more than you have to introduce them to the floor. You know, they know that it's there. It seems like this is a swing from one ditch into another. Jeff earlier was talking about, you know, the Pelagian street preachers who tend to do the shock and awe and hellfire and brimstone kind of preaching. And so maybe this person is thinking, well, very similar to the tweet that says starting out with God's love, just swinging into the wrong ditch. You're just going from one ditch into the other. Let's just stick with the Bible. Mm. Well, why is that so difficult?
That bad tweet by Phil Drysdale. Next tweet.
Repent, Phil.
Next tweet. Next tweet. Evangelism is a $175 billion business, and people like Limbaugh, Robertson, Beck are filthy rich from cranking this Jesus profit machine. Good tweet or bad tweet?
Yeah, it's a bad tweet because that's not evangelism. I mean, that's evangelism is a it's a certain message that we're proclaiming, the risen Christ. That's not the proclamation of the risen Christ. That's the proclamation of selfishness.
Right. There is truth in it, right? I mean, you were talking earlier, Jeff, about the books that you had and all these books about evangelism. There's no question that there is money in putting programs together, writing books, and things like that. And again, it's just denying the sufficiency of Scripture and the power of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, exactly. I guess, you know, the way the question kind of, or the way it was kind of put out there, I was just thinking of the just, you know, the money-hungry drive and a lot of the names that were mentioned, you know, like the TBN stuff and all of that. I mean, I never looked at that as being even compartmentalized evangelism. I just look at that as just a dog and pony show, you know? So, I mean, that's kind of what I was thinking. But you're right. I mean, obviously, there's different ways of looking at that.
The name of the tweeter might give us some insight as to where he was coming from. The name of that account that tweeted it is Injustice Facts.
Injustice Facts. Bad tweets.
Bad.
Next one. Let's see what you guys think of this one. If church leaders want their members to evangelize, they have to be willing to do so themselves.
Yeah, that's a good tweet. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, Paul said to Timothy, do the work of an evangelist. You know, I think there's an aspect of that, though, where there's got to be some wisdom used, because a pastor is primarily called to shepherd his flock. And so the main attention of his ministry should be to studying and preaching the word and ministering to those that are under his care. But with that said, definitely they should be evangelizing as well.
Spurgeon, yeah, and I've heard a great quote on that one, by the way. I don't have it memorized, but I know he talks about that as well in his lectures to my students.
Spurgeon?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've heard a saying, you know, what's practiced in the pulpit is copied in the pew. I think that's probably speaking a lot more of doctrine and service maybe and things like that. But there is no question that people tend to emulate their pastor. Not that the pastor needs to be, you know, there has to be a balance. I mean, there's so much that goes into being a pastor in terms of the study of God's word and sharpening himself and his doctrine and shepherding the flock, you know, weddings, funerals, counseling, all of those things. But, you know, evangelism should be part of their lifestyle. Now, that doesn't mean that they have to stand up on a box in the city square, you know. Are they reaching out to their neighbors? And, you know, what is their testimony in the community? I think that's one of the criteria for the qualification of an elder, right? Is how are they viewed by the community?
That tweet from, you guys will be happy to know this, Christianity Today magazine.
Wow.
Yeah.
Christianity Today.
When I did the search for evangelism on Twitter, one of our superhero tweeters showed up. The super theologian who looks like a black Phil Johnson. he actually tweeted, let the evangelism begin, and which was the caption for a picture that showed the super theologian next to a couple of Mormon missionaries.
Good on you, super theologian.
Yes. Our apologies to our superhero tweeters. We'll be, Lord willing, addressing some more of your tweets next week. But we wanted to focus on evangelism. But the winning superhero this week is definitely the super theologian, because he happened to pop up on our evangelism search. The very last tweet for this episode is, the Reformed faith eliminates the quote-unquote worry aspect of evangelism.
Good tweet.
Good tweet. Yeah, it's totally in the hands of God. I mean, that is the sovereignty of God, and evangelism is just, you know, and the understanding of man and the understanding of God does release us to worship Christ in the open air as we proclaim his name, other than, you know, obviously trying to manipulate and persuade men. I mean, I know we're called to persuade men, don't get me wrong, but I'm talking about in the sense of the manipulation factor and the pragmatism that comes when you don't trust in the sovereignty of God.
Amen.
Right, yeah, and we had that. We did a two-part series just a couple weeks ago on the doctrine of election, and it came up, you know, with regards to evangelism. Imagine the burden of thinking that another man's or woman's salvation is in your hands. You know, it's just the that's so upside down. And when you understand the utter sovereignty of God and salvation, you can just completely turn it over to His hands and faithfully proclaim the word.
Mm-hmm. And if you don't understand Reformed theology, if you don't understand the sovereignty of God in salvation, you could go to bed at night, like we said during our other episode a few weeks ago. You could go to bed thinking, well, what if I would have said this or that or that? Did I communicate this right? Be all worried about whether we're doing evangelism right. And this conversation goes right into an email question that I got. And let me just say, we connect with our listeners on lots of formats, on Twitter, on Facebook, on Mixler, on YouTube, lots of different places. But if you want us to address a question, we might miss it on all those platforms. Where we don't miss it is if you email us at BibleThumpingWingnut@gmail.com. So we got a question that is kind of dovetails right into that last tweet. That last tweet, of course, I forgot to say, was from Ocean of Grace. Very good tweet, Ocean of Grace. So I got an email this week with a question. Why is Arminianism no longer seen as a heresy? Is the Arminian gospel the same as the biblical gospel?
Well, I would say for the most part, most people who profess to be Arminians are not really Arminians.
I don't meet a lot of people who claim to be Arminian. They either say that they're a Calvinist or that they're nothing.
Right. Yeah, Jeff, what was that quote you said before? A half Calvinist is a, what was that?
Oh, yeah, Andrew Fuller. Yeah, he said that a moderate Calvinist is a half Arminian.
Why is Arminianism no longer seen as heresy? What would be the obvious difference in the proclamation if you were not Reformed and you were strongly Arminian?
I would say obviously free will would be one of the main things that they would proclaim. And, you know, when you look back through history, you see that men during the Reformation, the Scottish Covenanters, many of these men were burned at the stake over the issue of free will. You know, why it's not looked at as heresy today, I think a lot of that has to do with because the majority that you see out there is Arminian. They've had such a heavy influence, you know, but we see the same thing in Spurgeon's day as well. You know, when Spurgeon came onto the scene, I mean, it was heavily Arminian. And so they were the battles that he was up against. But I think a difference why I would look at it and say it is heretical is because, you know, obviously if man is dead, is depraved, is blind, they hate God, they don't want to come to God, and then you're telling them that they can choose to come to Him by their own free will. I mean, that's obviously goes against Scripture.
That Galatians 1:8-9, right? If anyone comes to you preaching a different gospel, and Paul even said, whether myself or angels or anybody comes to you preaching another gospel, let him be accursed.
Now, I'll just clarify that too, just to say what I said in the beginning too, that most people that I speak to are not really Arminian. They're confused, and they're not consistent in their doctrine. So, I mean, if without even going through the doctrines of grace or saying what they are or using the word Calvinism, it's almost a curse word to people. So mm-hmm. Without even using the terminology, you know, if I start off with total depravity and, you know, you go through the 5 points, in Scripture, they'll affirm every one of them.
Right.
So that's why, I think most people who profess to be Arminian are really not.
Yeah, there's just kind of some form of synergism that's snuck in there somewhere. And that's really why most of the, we use the word Arminian pretty, like you said, we don't really know of any Arminians in the truest sense of the word, as it's been understood historically. But those who hold to a synergistic gospel, I can still embrace as my brothers because of the inconsistency in their doctrine. I have a brother who I preach and do evangelism with. He was with us in New York City for the Super Bowl outreach. This guy prays like the most Calvinistic prayers you've ever heard. God, only you can do this. Only you can do this. But then you'd hear him witness to someone and he would be talking about free will. And I was like, dude, don't you see? It's just one of those things where you can't be the Holy Spirit to people.
Well, free will is saying that their will isn't in bondage to sin. And if it's not in bondage to sin, then they're Pelagian. They're Pelagian. Ultimately, they would come from a Pelagian background. And so when they're you know, telling people, make a decision, you choose, make a choice, and they're just almost so hyper-stimulated from that kind of preaching out there, as if, like, you know, they're almost treating people like they're victims, not criminals. You know, and they have this whole Unitarian concept, almost humanism out there. It really, you know, it really backfires, I think, and really is it makes a mess of things out there. Because I know that, you know, we're doing a gospel work. We're proclaiming, and, you know, we're doing a work in a certain area. And then if we have others that would come in and begin to preach alongside of us, we don't really know them that well, and they'll come in and they'll start preaching, you know, free will and all these things. It really stifles the work of God. It really does, because how is God going to be pleased with a message that's really not biblical? The guy is ignorant in one sense. I mean, you don't want to. I mean, we're all growing. I mean, obviously, I don't want to put myself on a pedestal and use myself as a standard, because we've all come to different places, and God has really, you know, revealed certain things to us at certain times and in his own way. But I have seen just recently where, you know, I would finish preaching, and another guy that would come on and preach after me would start preaching this stuff, and I would just think to myself, he has just preached everything contrary to what I just preached. And if I go up and preach now, I'm going to preach everything contrary to what he just preached. And what kind of message are we sending the people out there? And what kind of message are we preaching before our Lord? So these are the kind of questions you've got to ask yourself, especially in the day and age that we live in. Are we just to sit there and say, you know what, let's just, you know, agree not to agree, agree just to disagree, and go ahead and just move forward? Or are there, is God calling us now in the age that we live in to take a stand and make those decisions? Is this a hill worthy of dying on?
I bet you that question will be answered at the Herald Society.
Absolutely.
Reformers and their doctrine.
Philadelphia, October 23rd to the 25th. Again, the speakers are going to be Jeff Rose, Cy Tem, Brugenkate, Tony Miano, Jeff Durbin, Jeffrey Kirkland, Chris Sipley, Robert Gray, Mark Spence, Kevin St. John. Go to Jeremiah Cry Ministries to register. Early registration, there's a bit of a discount if you get on there before September 15th and get yourself registered to go. You do not want to miss this. You do not want to miss this conference. Look them up on Facebook. This is going to be time and money very well spent.
And two people from, two of us. Is Jay one of us? Is Jay a Bible-thumping wingnut? Jay with Wrath and Grace.
You think he's not? Of course.
He's on the Bible-thumping wingnut team. Two of us, Jay with Wrath and Grace and myself, will be at the Herald Society and will be broadcasting live. So, Lord willing, we'll have a great number of those speakers on the podcast that day. But you need to go.
JeremiahCry.com. Go to JeremiahCry.com. Get yourselves registered.
Amen. We want to thank you guys, Dave, Jeff. It's been a blessing. It's been a blessing to meet you guys and to hear your heart. To hear the gospel just pour out of your thoughts, and just your sharing was a real blessing. I'm sure our listeners were blessed as well.
Well, thank you guys. I mean, we love your show and really support what you guys are doing, and have greatly benefited from your programs. And thank you for having us on. We see it as a great privilege and honor.
Oh, we appreciate that.
Thank you very much, brother.
For those of you who are listening to Blog Talk Radio.
What are you doing? Stop it. Just stop.
They need to go to our new YouTube account. Right, Len?
Right. Flip, dude. Yes, check out the YouTube channel. We got the show posted there. You can like and subscribe to the channel there. And of course, please come and check out the iTunes feed. Check us out on SoundCloud. And coming very soon, in fact, if you're listening to the podcast, it may very well be available right now, BibleSomethingWingnut.com. We are I'm so close, I can almost touch it. We're almost there.
Next week,
for sure, you will be able to listen live to the Bible Thumping Wingnut on BibleThumpingWingnut.com. Not only that, but you can listen to it mobile on your device. We got the website set up for mobile, so you can even listen on the go.
Yeah.
So check it out.
Who are we having on next week, Len?
Next week, very exciting show. Pastor Mike Abendroth. With No Compromise Radio. They're very excited.
And anybody in the chat today? Anything interesting happening in the chat today?
There's some interesting things happening in the chat. We got our friend Frankie, who is helping us, working hard, getting us going on the website. So thankful for the work he's putting in there. Matt Yester, the most patient man on YouTube, is joining us. He had a four-hour debate on the doctrines of grace. Hello.
You don't even know him, man.
You don't know. Hello.
What?
Hello, Matt Yester.
What?
He was. He had a four-hour debate on YouTube this week with
Arminian.
With an Arminian. Amy Farmer is with us, a wonderful sister in the Lord. We are thankful that she joined us today. Don Sweetster is with us in chat also. We were interacting a little bit. So we're thankful for all of you who listen live on Mixler.com/BibleThumpingWingnut. You can check us out if you want to listen live and get the raw version, the unedited Bible Thumping Wingnut. I recommend you just wait till it comes on the podcast feed and get the best possible product that you can. But you can come and interact with us live in the chat and check us out on Mixler.com/BibleThumpingWingnut.
Yeah, bro. Will Cornrow Colin Pearson be here next week?
I'm not sure it matters, to be honest with you. Do we need him?
Did you kick him off the team?
No, dude, we couldn't do this without him. He's the artist formerly known as Cornrow Colin Pearson. It's buzz cut now, but yeah, he'll be with us next
week. We're going to auction off his cornrows.
Yeah. Hopefully we get enough to pay for all these fees and expenses that we're racking for this cash-negative hobby that we've developed.
For the glory of God.
Amen. Kurt Dog joined us late.